yes, another privileged white male on stage giving you advice. Sorry for that. It's a strike. And then putting a Dane after a Swede, that's unfair. The Swedes are like the gods of Scandinavia, and the Danes are probably more like the hobos, just drinking. And I have a yellow dot, but it doesn't match anything. So I'm trying. And speaking of being privileged, I made a big hello. I came with a lot of confidence to this conference, and there's a ceremony tonight, and Hello Monday have been privileged with winning so many nice things during the year. Is this working? I love this. I'm gonna do this. So I was preparing that this talk was just capturing you guys with just one big portfolio stream of 11 years of work. And then now that I'm fortunate enough to be here without my partners, I could just go on stage and do my Hail Mary, point towards somebody I didn't know. And then Sarah from Awwwards sent me this. It's not a personal email. I don't take it. I'm not throwing anybody under the bus, but then I got an email about us not winning tonight. I was like, gee, try to give your speaker enthusiasm. I was like, oh, shit. So I've been practicing my good for you. Like, yeah, it's your time to glow. So I start with a much more humble, this is still not working. Humble, politeful, hello. I'm Jeppe. But it also made me think. We had a road trip from Denmark. We drove my big French family car together with our tech lead and a former employee who's going to speak here later. And we were talking about Torben, our tech lead, has been in the company for 8 years. We practically breastfed him with the. He's a big guy, with coat since he was like this tall. We were talking about the things that when you've been in a company for so long, you see a lot of beginnings, and you see a lot of endings. And I think that Steve Jobs was the first one putting something to an end in our company. We were based on developing in Flash. That was action scripting. Our developers loved it, and then he killed it. And we looked into the big black hole of HTML, and we didn't know what to do. But I think that was our first lesson that we're like a cork thing, we come up again. So I decided this talk should be about decisions we made, less about our work, because obviously it's not worth anything. No, I'm kidding. It still has some value. I'm lucky enough, as I said, my three other partners is back home in Denmark, so I could make myself to the hero of this. It's nice. I made Johanne, who's a designer like me as well. She's the horse. And it's not a discriminating thing. It's more, she is really a workhorse. She's the one carrying me because I'm really lazy. So I'm privileged to have her on board. Then we have Anders. He's the sneaky fox. He's our dev guy. He's actually the one that made me and Joe being able to speak at conferences like this and not at Typo Berlin or another offline conference. And then in the little clever worm in the Big Apple, that's Andreas. He's the only one who actually have some kind of education. And he's the one who started our New York office. But I don't think he's as important as the three of us because we are the creatives. So this is a talk about like our road to creative freedom, 11 years. And when you head on to a journey like this, the first thing you meet is always, it hits you how clients can be. I mean, it's like big, nasty creatures just standing in front of you. And they often bring their dog called Hurry Up and Wait. I don't know how many of you have met that dog. It's like terrible. Always talking about deadlines, and you know, you sit over the weekend and then you deliver what they ask for, and then weeks go by and they get back and say, yeah, can you do another round? And I think what we learned in that case was that if we needed to survive in this business, we needed to believe more in ourselves and respect our time as well. So we started saying no. We just started challenging the client as well a lot more. And one of the right before that happened, we stopped and we said, no, don't eat us. And this little guy came to us. It's not a chronological. It's not in. It's a couple of years ago, I guess. He came up. Not that guy, but the team behind him. And they asked us, we need a new platform for Android.com. It's a pitch. We do pitches. I know somebody yesterday didn't do pitches. We are for sale for very low money in that case. But I believe, like using the metaphor of painting the house, I believe that if you do a pitch, then paint it in a different color than the client is asking for. So, of course, I think we talked about it right before. Everybody who has an iPhone looks like this. Maybe not on the outside, but at least on the inside. I'm one of them. That's how I feel I look when I have, like, my iPhone. Oh, I don't have an iPhone, so that's something else. Whatever. But, you know, that's what Android wanted. And as you could see in the numbers before, reality isn't like that. Android is actually more like this. This is the true Android users. This is the heroes. This is the guy who runs through traffic in Mumbai, like trying to save lives because he needs to navigate while he's looking at his Android. But we thought this was much more interesting. Why not show the real people of who's using Android and talk about that history? So that was what our pitch was about, like being honest, showing who it actually was instead of the hipster surfer dude. So basically, that's how our pitch ended. Not well. We should have gone with the surfer dude. But the weird thing is, at that meeting, this is fake news days, this is photoshopped. It's not a guy who's given birth to Android in real. I photoshopped it. It seemed more fun than just having Andy Rubin is the guy behind Android. He started it before it was bought by Google. And we didn't know, but he was sitting at that Skype meeting or Hangout meeting we were having with them. And he saw our pitch and he really liked our honest approach. And a couple of months after Andy stopped at Google, he started Playground, which is a tech experimental company. And he came to us. He had a 5-week deadline for a new website he needed to create for a new phone he created called the Essential Phone. So again, back to, did I say something about like we needed to say no to bad deadlines? We forgot in this case. We created a website for Andy for his new Essential Phone. And I think that shows that sometimes you can do pitches, but be true to yourself. I hate using the word karma, but there is some kind of karma. If you are true to yourself, it'll come back twice as good afterwards. So I'm in Germany, so I thought I can bring out some telecom stuff. Who knows telecom, actually? Everybody, maybe. It's a German phone company, quite big. And they asked us to create a wow experience. What is a wow experience? I never I never figured that out. And we were a part of a group of 10 agencies, the only one not from Germany being invited. Well, I think they asked us because they wanted a digital experience, I guess. And we didn't want to give them a wow experience. We were thinking that there's something wrong with the industry. They want to sell more phones, more data, more of more. And this is kind of what we came up with. So McDonald's got this salad. I know there's a bunch of calories in that. The car industry is beginning to make like environmental friendly cars. But what about that guy? I actually don't have a smartphone. But I experience it a lot. I can see some of your glowing faces. So some of you are on their phone. But that feeling about being isolated, and that's actually Telecom's fault. You know, that's those guys did something to the social thing. So we invented a device that were taking this picture or this illustration towards this. It's a much nicer world, right? Together. So we created the Nomo, no mobile, no one's missing out. And we pitched it into Telecom. And they actually loved it. It's actually a device that makes you use less data, but they really like the thought that maybe you can actually push a brand towards something else where you as a customer like it more because they're actually thinking about how you use their products instead of just headlessly thinking that you should use more data. And I think, again, it's a privilege in a way to... They invited us because they expected a cool website. And I think it's so nice to be able to just say, like, fuck it, let's do something else. Let's try to change something. So, we dealt with the client. Now it's like more mentally, you meet this rabbit. It's always British. Sorry, Mr. Binger, I'm trying to do a British dialect here. So you know, the rabbit comes up to you. It's like saying, yo, mate, what's up with the time? You know, what the fuck, you used all the time. Was that okay?
Lovely.
Thank you. So, at one point we were five partners, and I remember we had a meeting, and we looked at the economy. I never look at economy because I'm number blind. I can't see numbers. So I was sitting there at least, and then we were talking about we're not using time effectively enough, and the rabbit pulled out these two cakes. The one is the harvest cake. Do you know the time registration program called Harvest? How many of you are slaves to Harvest? I'm so sorry. Are you okay? Yeah. And then this is the gut feeling cake. The cake was just like, did I use 3 hours today? Yeah, maybe. Is it good enough? Yeah, maybe. Or maybe not. So we actually decided to take a bite of Harvest. And after, I guess, 3 months, the first ones who didn't use Harvest anymore was the partners. And we decided to take a bite of the gut feeling cake. And I think it opened up for another perspective as well, that we weren't worried about how much time we spend on the project. We weren't worried about money in the project either, because if we said yes, we wanted to create great websites and experiences, no matter what. And the first one it led to was doing work for Greenpeace, and they don't have enough. Yeah, they don't have enough money, obviously, but they have some money, and we did a website for them, and that kind of also shaped our destiny in a way, because if you say yes to Greenpeace, it's really hard to say yes to an oil company right after. And it's really hard to ignore that client on your portfolio as well, and also for other companies. And that kind of started some interesting discussions when we had partner meetings about what we could say yes to and no to, which... This thing also led to working for Nat Geo with the Bears View, where cameras on bears. eventually we met Emmanuel. He's a Belgian prince. Yes, we met a prince. He's a park ranger at the Virunga Park in Congo. He takes care of a bunch of gorillas down there and preventing them from poaching. And we're working with them as well. And I think, again, back to the awards, I'm not winning tonight. Okay, still no. Sorry. I think this is where, also talking about these 5 years of going into the same loop, that maybe we're just an old company, and maybe it's time for somebody else to shine, but then at least we can create some other meaning. And I think it's also, when you're very young, winning awards is everything. And I think we also grown. This is just a bad excuse for us not winning tonight. So I'm trying to convince myself that it's okay. But I really mean it. I think it's, for me, it's so much more giving to work with these kind of things. It's really nice for me to be able to send our employees to Congo. I would never go there. I'm way too scared of leaving Europe. It's one thing. So I sent two other guys. But I mean, giving them that privilege of experimenting this and seeing these things having such a deep impact with the gorillas. This is from Morten, that's our creative director in New York. And I mean, to me, it's worth at least two awards, maybe, that he had that experience. I think it's so nice to be able to have a company, and to me, I actually get more proud of what we're doing when we can do stuff like this. And again, our latest project, working with the Human Rights Watch on this project as well, is just, you know, I think it makes it easier, because you know the big guy out there, when he stands in front of his door and he asks you guys to see your portfolio or your Behance profile, you know, I think I have like an okay chance at least to go in there on this portfolio. I think that's kind of nice that maybe he opens the door to us. So the last thing you see is kind of these illusions, I think, that also happens in growing. It's really weird when you are just a normal graphic designer, and then suddenly you wake up one day and there's 38 other depending on you. It's not very nice, actually. It's very far from what I learned in school. There was poster design, and I think we had some flash as well, but nobody never taught me to be somebody who took care of 40 people. And it's easy at that point to begin to look at, I mean, these girls look so sexy when you see them at first. I've given them kind of Italian names. Produzione, Espansione, Mentantira. Makes them sound a little bit more sexy. And that's how you see it at first. And you know, you go along with it. You're kind of like, oh, this is cool. Economy looks good. Like, we're growing, more people. Woo! And then you wake up one day and they turn into this factory. Like you're sitting with your life work and you're just looking at it and thinking, why did we do this? Why did we end up with all these people? And none the least, why did we end up with clients who every day call us and want maintenance or production? So I think what we also said no to was, oh shit, is this very visible? I should have picked another color. Okay, looks like I'm sweating from a third nibble. So we had these clients, and they're very nice clients, but at one point it just turned into production. With all of them, it's like a marriage, you know. It's a relationship. After 3-4 years, it's like you're beginning to, okay, should we experiment with something else? Not that kind, but no. Watch other movies or stuff like that. But luckily, we said no. I was out eating at a very nice agency yesterday, and somebody said, "Can you turn down the Hello Monday A9?" Which were the Beoplay stereo. And we're so happy that we weren't working for them anymore, because that was kind of like, shit, if we'd become the B&O Play agency, that would have sailed our destiny forever. So I'm happy that we got away from them. This is an example of clients I think we are still really have a good relationship with. This is a conversation. I wanted to show you guys something from what we are doing with Google. We've known Google for 8 years. I know, like, things, it's not looking good in the news these days with Google and how they keep data. The people I met at Google over my 8 years is that it's really nice people. I still believe they're not trying to be evil. Maybe I'm naive. So I wrote to Katrin, who's a designer in Copenhagen, and said, "Hey, Katrin, can I borrow some imagery from the project you're using? I want to show an example." And you know, she says, "Nah, I think it's still a secret project. What do you need it for?" And then I said, "Oh, I want to blur it and use it something else to tease it so you guys could see what we were doing." And she says, "Is this a test?" She's thinking I'm trying to trick her to break the NDA of the project. So it's like that kind of boss she thinks I am. And then, you know, it ends up me never being able to get anything from her in my own company. So I have to blur a Wurst. I was in Germany. I thought that was maybe the most interesting thing to blur. I know it looks different from your angle, probably. It becomes very big phallic thing. We've been working a lot of years with Google, and we've been fortunate enough, I think, they opened the doors to go behind a lot of the things that are happening. And again, it's very weird that we can't show any of this stuff. When you look at our portfolio, I feel like we are makeup artists. But behind the company, there's so many people who got good thoughts and it's not just visually talented, but also really good thinkers. Another example of a nice relationship is the work we've done with YouTube also over a couple of years, and we did the kids app for them. We tried to actually create an app that was nice to kids, but also had some kind of ethics in it, so it goes to sleep after a certain amount of while, because we don't think kids should be on their iPad all the time. It's not good for them. And then last year, they needed to update the universe we created. And they came back to us, and we had a workshop, and I actually drew this really nice sketch, which was where the new identity should be. And it ended up us making a universe within a day at a workshop, and we created a bunch of characters who were supposed to come from the universe of YouTube, so burnt marshmallows and, of course, a lot of cats. This is not making the animation, but this is Mr. Bottle Flip, and of course the dinosaur costume. So, I mean, this is so nice, and the team at YouTube is just super nice. They took my drawing and put it into a frame next to their own homemade Mr. Marshmallow, and they made Pringle Toast in oversize. That's YouTube being so nice to us, and to me, that just says everything, that even though these big giants, you see them as these like unbeatable things, there's people behind it as well, and these people want to do something that is also actually quite okay. And working with YouTube also brought us, and Google as well, brought us into this book. And I mean, us being in a book, I'm like the most less clever person in the world, in Denmark at least, in Scandinavia. And then we are being put into the sprint book. And it was me and Joe who made a small practice with some of our clients, and we just invented it at the place, and they liked it so much that they put it into a book. And I, again, it's not award-winning, but to me, it's it shows that we have been growing in some way, that we went from this very visual agency to somebody who can actually do different things than what we believed in the beginning. And then, how long have I been speaking, actually? Last time that Hello Monday spoke, we spoke for 1.5 hour, and I promised Oscar that that was way too long as well, I thought. So, this is Casper, our designer at the Copenhagen office. And I don't know how many of you saw this project we did, but I think that's a project I did. This is this is the top of my career. This is where I peaked. It was when we turned 10 years, we made a poster series about the Bendies. We called it Bendy 10. 10 Bendies. It was a sketch I made at a client meeting. I don't know why. It was a client who talked a lot about himself. And then Joe saw it and she said, could we use it for something? And then we made the poster series. I love this. This is when you get in to the website. And you can only... And then Anders had the idea of... thank you. And then Anders had the idea that you could only use it on mobile because it's perfect for bending. So if you use a laptop, it's way too heavy. And we're very... Like, with your back, you should take care of it, you know? So in that way, we have ethics as well. And I want to show, this is the case video we sent into the different awards, just to wrap it a little bit up. Let's see. Is it working? Maybe.
Today's self-obsessed, self-promotional society is struggling with a very difficult issue. People find themselves more and more often with their heads stuck up their behinds. Every day, every second, this phenomenon occurs, whether it's on Instagram, in traffic, on the job, or even in the White House. More and more people fall victim to this dangerous trend. As a result, they become unable to see what's actually happening around them. This seemingly innocent move costs society, if not millions of dollars every day, than at least millions of relationships. Bendy 10 is a collection of 10 posters raising awareness of this important problem. We came up with an e-commerce solution that sells posters as well as spreads knowledge. To enter the site, which is only available on the ultimate device of the self-involved, the mobile, we forced the customers / future activists to test their own bendiness in order to purchase the poster of their choice. This experience will make people realize not only how annoying it is to have their heads up their ass, but also how painful it can be. The message is clear. Don't do it. Unless you want a poster. Will we have the time to screen dump all the adoring tweets the site will get? Probably not. We are, after all, busy trying to make a difference in the world. Caring is a full-time job. Our dedication and tireless work will for sure give Bendy 10 a lot of deserved attention, which we may or may not have time to care about. We've got a lot going on, you know. But we predict a success of epic proportions. Bendy 10 is amazing. It's going to be huge.
Yeah. So still, after saving all the gorillas and so on, this is still my best project. So the conclusion is that before we said yes to a lot of things, and when we started saying no, it actually became much better. We added a unicorn, for example, which is the top of greatness. I think saying no is not only a good thing. We actually also have a yes list. Be good. It's a good thing, mostly. Try the truth. I try that, like my third nibble. It's good. I have an ethic codex. We try to have an ethic codex. We have a little book in Hello Monday. We try to read in it. It's not the Bible. It's another book that we created. And it got some really nice things. in it as well, and it helps us navigate sometimes. Saying no to power is true power, and I said no to the award. That's the truth, actually. I said no. We don't need it. Like, we're bigger than that. We're not slave to the award. I said it to the jury members yesterday as well. Don't vote on us in the future either. And then, of course, team up with somebody who don't believe in the above. That's actually my learning. There's none of the other partners who believe in what I just said. And I think that's a good thing. We got a lot of good discussions, actually, about that. Is time okay, Oscar? Finish? I'm going to go 10 minutes more because of the award thing. So, yes, it perfectly. We went out in sunset, everything is perfect. We got the princess, but there's more good stuff ahead. So, thank you. Oh, what a nice background. Boom.